There are stars and there are superstars.
I'm like, I'm fast. He's faster.
Was as good an athlete as the country has seen probably since Jim Thorpe.
To me, he's the greatest athlete of the 20th century. There's not even an argument there.
Every two or three days, he would do something to make you just kind of scratch your head and say, man, I don't know if I saw that right, you know?
There's something mythical about everything that he did.
He was like a rocket ship that was fired out of a cannon.
He was excitement incarnate.
He was untouchable.
He was just better than everybody else.
All we saw was a man doing things that we had no idea were humanly possible. Then out of nowhere, he was gone.
He was one of the last athletes who the information about him was anecdotal, that you wouldn't necessarily see the things you heard about them, but there was kind of like this legendary, kind of like Paul Bunyan description around him.
From the time he was a little kid, he was almost like a Paul Bunyan type of figure. He was this larger-than-life ideal.
And the stories were always very vivid because not only were they amazing, they were often very weird. I remember hearing a story that, you know, when he was in eighth grade, he dunked a stick. That he had like found a stick and he was on an outdoor basketball court as an eighth grader and he dunked this stick or whatever. It was a strange story. It was so strange that like it seemed real, because why would someone make up the idea that he was dunking a stick? Yeah.
I don't know if it's true or not, but I was told it was true.
One person would have seen the thing and then the next person absolutely didn't see it, but he heard a person talk about having seen it. So he can say that he saw it, and then you tell the next guy, well, did you see it? Yeah, I saw it.
The things he did were so incredible and so unbelievable that people want to talk about them. People want to keep that stuff alive.
I would probably tell you 99% of it is true.
And he's fun to think about. He's fun to remember.
And I think he enjoyed elevating that myth. He enjoyed playing around with it a little bit. I think he still enjoys playing around with it a little bit. I think all of that is part of who he is.
Who is Ryan Stewart to you?
To me, he's a competitor. He's my competitor, he's my opponent.
Ryan was an athlete. He was just an athlete. There are no other words to describe him. I mean, he played every sport and he played them all well. I mean, whether it be baseball, basketball, golf, tennis, he played them well and he was just a star in all.
I don't see Ryan as a threat on the golf course, no.
In any aspect of the game?
No.
I'm Ryan's wife, Maureen.
So you would say you know Ryan pretty well.
I would say I do.
Talk to me about his pain, specifically his body pain.
Well, some have called him a baby, but I think he's handled it quite well.
I got him a little PT appointment with a specialist.
Why?
Try and work out some of his aches and pains, give him some exercises to work through.
His body caught up to him. You know, it caught up to him, and that's really the tragedy in all of this, is that it did.
People want to talk about Ryan like it's his personal battle.
Got some shoulder pain, pretty bad shoulder pain. I'm sure that's going to limit me. Some heel pain. Makes it basically impossible to walk long distances. And a little bit of knee pain. And mostly the walking pain affects my golf game because I have to aim for the carpet. Because I can't walk.
If he had picked one sport from the beginning, no doubt in my mind he would be a first ballot Hall of Famer, maybe top five all time in any of those sports. But the fact that he not only played four sports, but he played them all so well, it just had a toll on his body, and he was never the same after that. He was a shell. He was a shell of his former self.
Did you ever think you would play again?
Never. Never thought I'd play again. Didn't even know if I would walk again.
Did you ever think he would play golf again? Did you ever think Ryan would play again?
Play golf again? Yes. You literally swing a club 100 times if you're him. 75 if you're good. Clearly, I didn't think I would see him on the golf course again.
Did you ever think you would play golf again after that?
I was a little bit worried that he wouldn't. But I knew that he would get back out there.
Did you go to any sort of therapy for your pain?
Mental, physical, occupational.
And then, you know, obviously when you're going through all this pain, I mean, he had three different pinpoints, you know, at all times, whether it be his back, his shoulder, his knee, his foot. He was always in pain, and he, unfortunately, you know, he had a reliance on drugs.
After when you have injuries like me, you just sort of get addicted to those, pain-killing kind of drugs and different forms of the same drug, trying to get that same high, get rid of the pain, and that just sort of take over your life.
What about his opioids?
His opioids, well, he tried to press them on me, but, you know, I didn't want that to ruin my golf future and my career, so, you know, I said, no, keep that for yourself.
Would you say he takes a significant amount of painkillers to alleviate some of this pain?
I'd rather not talk about that.
And it was sad to watch, you know, this man who was once so highly renowned to have fallen from grace so quickly. It was sad.
How have you fought against that?
Beer. A lot of beer. And, sometimes I chew on grass. Just blades of grass. It's a little weird, but it's just this natural flavor. It's good.
Some would say he is addicted to Fortnite. Talk to me about his Fortnite.
I would say his obsession is a bit extreme when he's watching other people play and he's not even the one playing.
Have you say it's gotten in the way of your marriage at all?
Yes.
It's been rough. There's been a lot of screaming, slapping.
He said that he once clicked on a YouTube video for Fortnite. He didn't know they were out there. He watched one video, clicked on another one, and 3 hours later, he was still watching Fortnite YouTube videos, and I'm like, okay, that's a bit weird, okay? Like, that's something eighth graders do, okay? Not something 30-year-old lawyers do.
Any comment on Fortnite?
It seems like a complete and total waste of time.
Are you ashamed that your sons are playing?
No, but it does seem like a complete and total waste of time.
He literally made a handshake with me for Fortnite.
It's probably hindered my recovery.
Why is that?
Because I spend so much time playing Fortnite and watching Fortnite YouTube videos that I can't practice walking or running or swinging a golf club.
You know, you spend hours on hours, not just playing it, but practicing and preparing for future matches, watching videos, learning techniques, strategies.
But how do you feel when you play Fortnite?
Alive. Just so alive and powerful.
During the college football playoff, you know, his family's in town, and what does he do? He pulls a Fortnite. I mean, the guy was just addicted to Fortnite. You know, he wanted that fame that he once had with sports. And when he lost it, went through his injuries and then the drugs, he went to Fortnite because he felt powerful there.
How often would you say he plays Fortnite?
I can't be sure, but it's a lot. It's, I've caught him sitting on the toilet in the middle of the night. I have caught him in the morning sitting on the toilet playing Fortnite. I don't know, I'm not around him all the time, so he could be playing even when I'm not there. But he's worked to play less because he knows it has put a strain on our marriage.
It was wet. You know, it was so wet.
I remember it being wet. Very wet. The ball would bounce. It would roll about 2 inches total. And it was beautiful. Blue skies, beautiful, beautiful day.
Well, like I said, I never thought I'd play again. And I woke up and all of a sudden I was playing. And it was exciting and a little bit scary. And it was beautiful out. I had no idea it was gonna be so wet. And then I... It's so weird. I'm sorry.
Wait a second. In all likelihood, it made his story better. The fact that he had to rise from this. I mean, his career was up in flames. His career was up in flames, and he comes back. You know, not only does he come back, but he comes back that quickly. I didn't think I'd see it.
It was just so wet out there, and I stepped in a puddle on the first hole, and I didn't know if I'd be able to come back from that. I thought about withdrawing.
Your first 5 holes were, safe to say, rough. Nothing better than a double bogey.
I mean, he said he had played up to that. It didn't show. It was just atrocious.
First 7 holes, it was tough sledding. I had trouble getting warmed up.
Would you say it was an embarrassment to golf?
Yeah.
Do you think the weather conditions helped you in any way?
No, they definitely hurt me. Because my whole game is the bump and runs and the chip and runs and the little worm burners. And, you know, Jeff tries to do the high arcing stuff, which is just fine in the wet weather. But there were a lot of shots that I just kept thinking, if it wasn't this wet, that would have been in the hole. Yeah. And it's true.
Yeah, the first 7 holes was atrocious. I mean, it was an embarrassment to golf. It really was. And I don't mean that to be critical on Ryan, but it just wasn't up to his standards.
You gotta make a putt, you gotta hit a green, you gotta hit a driver, you gotta do anything. It's awful. No idea where that one went.
Well, to be honest, on the 4th hole, I was popping some opioids. Just trying to get back into the swing of things. And it helped a lot.
Are you looking at me?
You can't.
First 5 holes, I thought was pretty awful, to be honest.
When would you say things turned around for you? Yeah.
When the cart lady came by and I got a beer, and I took one sip, and I think this might be on video, I just immediately was like Popeye. So much bigger and stronger the next shot on the green in regulation, 2-putt par. It's history.
Well, to be honest, he drank a beer.
What do you think changed Ryan's momentum when he started to play well?
Pure athletic skill.
He seemed to start playing well after he started drinking beer.
That could have been it too. Skill and a little beer.
From that point on, he was a different golfer.
He got more comfortable, he got relaxed. Started hitting driver as well, so he wasn't gonna be hitting 4-iron in every green. And he was able to put some close to the green and chip and give himself chances for par, which he didn't do the previous 8. I take credit for buying Ryan a beer and turning this game around.
You know, it's funny because, you know, his legacy was tarnished by the amount he drank. And then for that beer to be the thing that brought him back in the match. I mean, I don't think of a storybook getting better than that.
No. I didn't think anyone would ever play that badly to be in competition with me. But I raised my game, and Jeff lowered his game, and we met in the middle. And for several holes, we were competing neck and neck. I had him on the ropes. And I let him go because I have forgiveness in my heart from my rehab program.
Look, there's four main aspects of golf. You gotta drive the ball well, you gotta hit good iron shots, you gotta be able to chip the ball well, you gotta be able to putt. And the first eight holes, Ryan did none of that well, or even remotely close to average.
From holes 8 through 12, you beat Jeff by 3 strokes.
Yep.
What do you have to say about that?
It's awesome. If that was the whole match, I would have won by 3 strokes.
You see, he finally decided to play average golf. You know, he was pulling off shots. He was getting up and down for pars and bogeys that Jeff was struggling to get up and down for bogey, and he would make double bogeys, and he just had this sense that something was different on this back nine.
And then 11th hole, you three putted for bogey. That angry.
Yeah, that was the putter was bad. And it had a little Fortnite logo on the end, so it was just distracting me the whole time. I thought it would help, so I put it there, but just distracted me. I was just thinking about Fortnite when I was supposed to be putting.
And Jeff hits a bad drive, and you're thinking, okay, this might be it. This might be Ryan's opening. And Jeff flicks Ryan off. He gives him the middle finger. Some would say it was a flick off. Some would say it was just a nice finger telling him hi. I like to think of the latter. Didn't think much of it.
Well, to be honest, there was a little unsportsmanlike conduct with the flick off. I don't know if you saw that, but it sort of riled me up a little bit in a way I was just not thinking straight. And, you know, I'm sure that the league will take a look at it and some kind of sanction will come down, but, you know, that is what it is. It's in the past for me. That's all I'm going to say about that.
Ryan told me before the shot that he was trying to get inside Jeff's head. He wanted to put the pressure on, and he did that, you know, by putting it by the green, because Jeff was just playing really atrociously. Ryan was in Jeff's head. You know, that's the thing that Ryan, that made Ryan excel. His entire career was getting inside his opponent's head. It dates back to his cocky days at Vanderbilt. Not only is he cocky, but he has the skills to back it up.
Really bad first shot. I just flaring it out to the left and came in with a really nice chip over the bunker next to the green, dropped it right down. Makeable par putt, but just a little bit too far. So I had to make sure that I two putted and stayed even with Jeff on the hole, which I did.
But Ryan's telling me if I can finish this hole being run back, he has no doubt in his mind he's gonna win. He says, I will win 100%.
At that point, I thought the match was mine.
How confident were you?
I mean, I was floating on rainbows. It was 95% in my mind. I thought I might get shot and not be able to keep going. That's the only way I'd lose.
You made what could have been match-flipping errors on the 16th hole. No one took advantage of it as you
have. Yeah, well, let me stop you right there. What happened is that he hit it out of bounds and didn't hit a provisional. I had no idea that it had gone out of bounds. I thought it was in bounds. And so I took a much riskier play. I think the league might look at this too. And, you know, he should have played a provisional. I understand that he might have dropped it even closer to the green.
I know I was.
I hit mine by a snake. And I think the snake knocked it into the water. So that's just happens.
And Jeff's tee shot on 16 goes out of bounds. And you're left with this thought, Ryan might do this. You know, Ryan might win. Ryan's tee shot goes in the water. And so they both had doors open for him on 16 for Jeff to either pull away or Ryan to take the lead. And neither of them took advantage of it.
Well, I was hoping that the ball would just be sitting up a little bit. I told my caddy, if it's visible, I'm hitting it. But I couldn't see it anywhere. So I had to take the drop and play from there. So that definitely hurt. I thought it was going to clear the water, but just came up a little short. Well, I don't know if I'd say he played it well. He tapped it off the tee to start. And, you know, like I said, the tape will speak for itself there.
I mean, it happens. But, I mean, it's not against the rules to pick that up. I wasn't intending to hit the ball. I'm allowed to do that. No foul play.
Because he doesn't like to lose and he gets angry. And I could see that that could lead him to skirting the rules. So he is not harmed by his poor play.
Basically, you know, I knew that the match was out of reach. And at that point, it was just about finishing strong and making sure that I could be proud of the way I finished.
For Ryan, it was just about finishing, right? Because he hadn't played a full 18 holes. It was just about finishing the round. On 18, you know, there was a hope for a miracle, but everyone knew it wasn't going to happen.
Just pounded as hard as I could until there was no tomorrow. And I hit it so hard that I accidentally hit the ground first and still hit it straight pretty far, considering that, I bounced off the ground into the ball. So I got it up onto the green, put it pretty close, but left myself a challenging 8-footer, triple breaker, and nailed it. So that was really the defining moment of the day, finishing the match after all I've been through. And, never knowing if I would play again and all, playing and finishing a match. It's just unbelievable.
I'm very proud that he got back out there and that he played through the round. And even though he struggled at times, he finished and he worked really hard to get there. So I'm very proud.
As a fan, one of the coolest experiences I've had at golf was watching Ryan's comeback. I mean, his career was gone, you know? I didn't think I would see him again. And here he is, almost a year and a half later, all that he's been through, the addiction, you know, the fall from grace, his legacy, career, up in flames, to be back. I mean, even though he didn't win, he pulled the greatest upset that day. He beat the odds.
I was kind of hoping that my defeat would put him back on opioids.
What are you going to do tomorrow?
I'm going to Disney World, baby. Harry Potter World, actually. I'm going to send some pictures to Jeff from there because he can't go.
I just know that they were laughing all the way around, which was all we were out there to do. Even if they had bad shots, they were laughing. Except Jeff sometimes was not laughing.
I don't think there's anyone else you can compare Ryan's story to. I mean, you could put Tiger Woods up there, but even that's a stretch. In all likelihood, it's the greatest comeback in sports history.
I just want to say to all the little kids out there that I'm proud to be a role model now, that you can push through anything and persevere and get to the other side. And I encourage you to do whatever feels good.
You can't compare Ryan to anyone. You can only compare people to Ryan. And there's not many people you can do that with.
And I think when history looks back on today, the only person that anyone will remember is me.
Where do I turn to when there's no choice to make? And how do I presume when there's so much at stake? I was so sure of it all. What if I need you in my darkest hour? What if it turns? Well, I've been running Darkest hour, and what if it turns?